The story of Reverse 1999 is fantastic, and that's because the game has so many foreshadowing clues that predicting what's going to happen is not only possible, but the payoff feels absolutely amazing. But that's of course if we are paying attention to these hints within the game. So in this video, I will outline 5 clues that you might have missed in the story of Reverse 1999. And as a quick disclaimer, this video does have spoilers from the first 3 chapters. One of the plot points in this game is the storm, a cataclysmic event that marks the end of an era and reversing time itself.
Why does everyone act as if nothing happens? These things are really weird.
And the cool thing about this concept is that the mutations of the world caused by the oncoming storm is symbolized by the iconic characteristics of the era. For example, the storm's mutation in the 1960s took the shape of raindrops that resembled paint, which heavily reflects the poppin' contemporary art culture in the 1960s. And in the 1920s, the storm's mutation took the form of materialism and money, which resembles the idea of the economic growth within the United States, of course eventually leading to the Great Depression. In a way, these clues are literally baked into the world building of the game, and I suspect that no matter what era this game takes us, if we are aware of these iconic characteristics within history, it would be really fun to predict these things and guess how the storm will take form within the story. Now, aside from historical clues, we can also see foreshadowing clues within the game. When I first saw Carson emerging from the vault, I swear, I cannot be the only one who thought he was being super suspicious.
Mr. Carson!
Miss Sotheby, you're back.
Why are you standing in front of our number 18 vault?
But of course, we eventually learned that he was hallucinating. Because the storm in the 1920s, the hallucinations caused humans to see money and gold as food, and in contrast, see actual food as basically trash. Now, while this explanation was straightforward in the game's storytelling, we do learn several things that were pretty important. First, humans are affected by the storm's hallucinations. And second, humans will eventually perish along with the storm. This was essentially the reason why Sotheby was trying to create a potion so that humans can eat and survive instead of suffocating to death by eating gold and money. Now, unfortunately for Carson, the story told us in this dialogue that he was human, which means regardless of the potion, he was already facing his predetermined fate. Now, many people probably picked up on these clues because the game literally told us moments after, but along with foreshadowing clues, there are also dialogue clues inside the game. At the end of chapter 2, we learned that of all people, Schneider was also a human.
I'm sorry. I'm not a real arcanist.
What do you mean? I don't understand.
This was obviously a very shocking revelation because we were led to believe that she was an arcanist throughout the entire story. But what's really interesting is that Schneider's real identity was also hinted to us during her dialogue with Sotheby. As Sotheby was trying to create the potion that would help humans to see real food again, Schneider directly asked Sotheby to use her as a guinea pig to test the potion.
Have you made the latest hallucinogen, my lady? If you are confident, you can pour it into my mouth.
But even if it's successful, he won't have any reaction.
Obviously, Sotheby was confused because it wouldn't work on an arcanist. In hindsight, this dialogue directly hinted that Schneider was a human this entire time. And of course, it was eventually revealed at the end of the chapter. Now, the interesting thing is if Schneider was human, how was she able to use arcane skills throughout the story? While it's not explicitly explained in detail, I do have a speculation. Consider this as my personal speculation, but in my opinion, with the context clues given to us from the story, I thought it made a lot of sense. So in chapter 2-3, Arcana poses a random question to Verton.
Lady Verton, what do you think of her pistol?
A great one.
Exactly. Which was improved by our finest wand maker, Druvis III.
She explains that Druvis, being a wand maker, altered Schneider's pistols. And my assumption is that this has made the pistol to become something like a medium that can be used by humans who has either low affinity or zero affinity to arcane skills for that matter. Now, while this might feel like a stretch, if we go back to the very beginning of the game, we can begin to see some possibilities.
Please use this. It will send us directly to the other side.
This is...
a portable floppy disk for the arcane skill teleport.
The floppy disk basically becoming a medium for arcane skills. Now, while the properties of Schneider's pistols and the floppy disk might be different, if the Foundation had the skill set to do this with the floppy disk, I reckon that maybe Manus Vindictae also had similar abilities. And if this is true, the pistol acting as a medium essentially gave off the false perception, and all the players, including the characters in the game, assumed that Schneider was an arcanist throughout the entire story. Now, as I mentioned, since the information behind Schneider's pistols is never explicitly explained, but personally, the more I think about it, I feel like it makes sense. The idea that the developer wrote the story and used the floppy disk as a plot device, which eventually foreshadowed the true nature of Schneider's pistol, leading to the final reveal of Schneider's truth and her secret identity. Now, speaking of Schneider's secret, let's take a look at the final clue that revealed itself at the end of the chapter. What you're seeing on the screen is the final gathering before the storm. But you probably noticed that this image is very similar to the Last Supper painted by Leonardo da Vinci depicting Jesus of Nazareth and his 12 apostles. The interesting thing about this painting is that if we compare them side by side to the version from the game, it's identical to the number of people, even down to several poses of different characters. Burton being at the center, obviously reflecting the seated position of Jesus, but what's absolutely mind-blowing is the fact that Schneider is placed in the seat of Judas from the original painting. You know, the one who was keeping a secret about his ultimate betrayal against Jesus? Which makes perfect sense since Schneider has been keeping the truth about her identity as a human from everyone, especially Burton. Another amazing clue placed right in front of her eyes, all the way up until the last moments of the chapter. Now, as I was looking at this depiction and thinking about this clue, there was one more thing that I just couldn't shake off. If this game has this many clues and foreshadowings, the question was, if Burton is depicting the position of Jesus within the painting of the Last Supper, that would mean that Burton will eventually end up having to make a final sacrifice. Again, this is purely just my speculation, and we might never get the answer, but maybe there is an answer, but not until everything is revealed, and we go back to look at all the small details that were given to us right in front of our eyes. So if you're interested in Verton's story and her lore, make sure to subscribe as I'll be digging into her backstory in my next video. And if you enjoyed this video, hit the like button, I appreciate it. And I also want to thank Reverse1999 for supporting my channel and making this video possible. Thank you all for watching, and I'll see you next time.